Hi, everyone. My name is Boris. Welcome to my talk. I work at Code Synthesis, where we develop open source tools and libraries for C++. Oh, hold on. I forgot my clicker. So the topic of my presentation today is building C++ with build2, which is a new build tool chain. Just a quick question before we begin. I have some fun stories to share, but we're short on time, so who's happy to stay 5-10 minutes over? Okay, seems like everyone is happy. But if you need to leave, of course, you're free to go. All right, so if you go on the web these days, there's a new build system or a new package manager popping up virtually every day, and they all say they are better. They're better than everything before them. But what exactly is better? So we're going to spend a few minutes discussing what we are trying to achieve here. And by we, I mean Code Synthesis. So our problem is fairly complex cross-platform, cross-compiler tools and libraries for C++. And over the past years, it has been getting increasingly painful to develop, test, and maintain them. But that might not be your problem. You know, you might be using Visual Studio, and your only target is Windows. So that would be a pathological kind of user for our build system. So we are kind of in completely different, pulling things in completely different direction. But even in this case, you might still benefit from something like build2 in case you are using some third-party libraries. So with build2, it's fairly easy to build them for your configurations and then, more importantly, keep up with their changes. All right. So before we go into the technical stuff, let me also talk a little bit about our kind of overall philosophy, what we are trying to get here. So the first kind of rant slash story, you know, these days I go to Hacker News or Reddit and, you know, you see all this, you know, there's a new release of something and there's comments, oh, it's so awesome, oh, I'm so excited, oh, I'm in love with this thing. And I always cringe about that when I read this. So we are not trying to build some kind of magic unicorn that, you know, will solve all your problems forever. So what we want something like Git. We want an engineering tool that allows you to get the job done. And if you think that Git is some kind of you know, soft warm puppy, then go try to use submodules. All right. So that's kind of our goal, an engineering tool. All right, technical. So let's now talk about our technical goals. First one is a uniform build interface. We want it to look exactly the same, be it Windows or Linux or macOS. We want it to work out of the box, even on Windows. We don't want to ask the user to install Python, MC, Sigwin. And installing is easy. Maintenance is hard. You know, there are new versions. You need to upgrade. Are they compatible with what you are doing? Ideally, we would want to just have a C++ compiler. And for example, build2 can be bootstrapped on a clean Windows XP box. We also want to handle development and distribution. This to pull the design in different directions. For development, you want powerful, flexible build system. You don't particularly care how portable it is. For distribution, the end user wants the simplest thing that gets the job done and gets out of the way. We also want reliable builds. Oftentimes, I used to find myself, you know, I'll go upgrade some packages, change some options, and then I go to my build system and say, okay, update everything. And say, hey, everything is up to date. And I don't quite trust it because I changed a lot of things. So just to make sure, I go clean it and rebuild it from scratch. And that's a waste of time. So we want to fix that. Cross-compilation. A lot of build systems these days just cannot seem to get it right for some reason. But I think if you start thinking from it from the grounds up, it's actually nothing special. So a good test, if you are developing your own build system, a good test to use, ask yourself, is it easier to cross-compile to Windows than to build natively? If the answer is no, then you're doing something wrong. Source code generation has become an F word of the C++ community, and we want to free it for something more appropriate. And the funny thing is, we don't just say, well, yeah, it's hard, you know, we cannot support it in our build systems. No, we say it's un-C++. You need to be able to do it with template metaprogramming. We also don't want a black box of a build system. These days, you will, let's say you need to do X, and you go and you find the documentation for your build system if you are lucky, and it says, well, if you want X, then stick Y into Z. And you don't even know, you know, at the conceptual level, what those Y and Z are. Are they functions? Are they values? Are they variables? So it's kind of all these things. So we want to build a mental model of, or have a mental model of how things are built, how things are described. And this is, becomes important if you want to build something a little bit different or completely different. If you have a black box, then you just need to start from, you know, building another black box from scratch. While at it, we want to fix the syntax. A lot of build systems these days look like this. I'm sure you know which one I'm talking about. All right, so these are our technical goals, kind of primary ones. Quick overview of the toolchain. It's called toolchain because it's a several tools. So there's the build system driver called B. For me personally, you know, typing make is too long, so we decided, well, let's go ahead and call it B. Then there's the package manager. There is a repository web interface. So it's an Apache module. We'll see in a second what it looks like. We are working on the build bot. So once we now have everything uniform, next natural step is to automate the whole thing. Then we started CppGet, which is a repository of open source packages, which we hope will become the repository one day. It's open source, licensed under the MIT, written in C++ 14. Self-hosted and self-packaged, so all the packages on cppget.org, supports all the major platforms, supports all the major compilers. So the Visual Studio and Windows support just landed in the last version. And it's a funny story about it. So the version before we announced on Reddit, and the first comment was this massive, you know, half a page long description of why we will never be able to support Windows because we kind of haven't started doing it from the grounds up. So I thought, okay, that's a good challenge. So as you can see, you cannot believe everything you read on Reddit. Right, so let's see some examples. So we're gonna start from the highest level and go all the way down to the build system. So nothing can be higher level than browsing some pages. So let's go take a look at that cppget.org. So if you get, maybe I'll make it a little bit smaller. So if you get on the front page, you'll see a list of packages, a search box where you can narrow it down. So you see basic information, summary, license, number of dependencies, and so on. So this, for example, the first package is a package for the package manager. Might sound funny, but there it is. So if you go select that, then you get a bit more information about it, you know, extract from the README file. And then you have a list of versions. Here we have one, but in build2, you can have several versions of the same package. And packages also in source. To me, it's kind of obviously right way to do it, but not everyone believes that. So let me also mention that everything is in source. We might support binary packages at a later stage in a much limited scope if we can truly capture the exact and exhaustive configuration in which you built them, which we might actually be able to do. We'll see the examples of that. So, and the packages, repositories in build2 are often subdivided in sections. For example, you can have stable and testing, or you can split them into miscellaneous and mathematical libraries, so you can have some combination of them. So for example, if you saw a couple of versions, as we'll see later, and you know, one is in testing and the other one in stable, and you are risk averse, and you'll go with stable. But here, the decision has been made for us. So if you select a package version, a specific package version, then there's a bit more detail about it. There's a URL for the package if you want to grab it yourself for some reason. There is the checksum. The more interesting part is probably this dependencies list. So you can see the dependencies and the versions that they require. And there's the extract from the changelog at the bottom. So overall, kind of all the basic information you would expect to see or to be able to access if you are looking for a package. Now, I mentioned that the toolchain is packaged itself, and we could actually use it as an example of itself, but that would take a while because we first need to bootstrap it, a chicken and egg problem. So instead, we're gonna use the customary hello example. So what we did is we created a couple of packages, a hello program, a libhello library, and a few other libraries. And we use them in our documentation in the introduction, for example. And we also run a little separate repository for them so that you know they don't mix with the real packages. So this repository, by the way, what you see is generated by this BREP module that I mentioned earlier. So here, the same look, but just different packages. So we have this hello program and some other libraries. So let's start from the perspective of a consumer. And by that, I mean, you know, someone packaged a library or a program and, you know, you want to build it. So let's say we woke up today and we decide, no, we really need to build a hello program today. So we go to the repository and we search for a hello program. And then in a more real world scenario, you'll see several. For example, you're looking for some popular library, let's say an XML parser. Then you can compare, you can see, okay, one is licensed in GPL, the other one is in MIT. You know, I prefer MIT, so I'll use that. Or you can check, take a look at the number of dependencies, and you know, one has 10, the other one has one, so you prefer the one with fewer dependencies. So in this case, it's decided for us. Again, we look at the version. Again, here we will see a little bit more interesting example in a bit. So here again, version is determined for us. So we read what this program is about. Let's say we like it, so we want to build it. So you could have gone and grabbed this package manually, you know, realized, okay, it depends on the library, so you grab that package manually as well, build everything. So that's how we more or less do things today. It's much easier to do it with a package manager, so we'll now go ahead and try that. So the idea is that we'll try to build this library and all its dependencies using the package manager. But before we do that, so in build2, you build packages in a configuration. Configuration is just a directory where you have a set of packages with similar settings. The same compiler, same optimization options, 32, 64-bit, and so on. So the configurations are cheap, easy to create, easy to destroy. Let's say we are in the mood for, I don't know, GCC 5 release build. So the first thing we do, we create a directory appropriately named. You want to keep your names kind of descriptive in case tomorrow, for example, we wake up and decide, no, we want clang release, so we can create another one next to it. So to create a configuration, essentially to initialize this directory to become a PKG configuration, we use the create command. So the CXX is the name of the build system module that implements C++ compilation. We'll talk about it in a bit later. And the other two arguments are configuration options. The first one, we specify the compiler we're going to use, and C options stands for compile options, so this is the optimization flag. So this is quite low level for some of you. It gives you complete control. So build system or the package manager doesn't kind of stick some helpful options for you. But the plan is to have eventually a higher level interface where you would just be able to say, for example, GCC 5 release, and it'll find the compiler and it'll figure out which optimization options to use. All right, so said it's created something. Let's take a look at it. Now, some package manager would say, hey, never look inside, you know, my private goodies. They are black box for you. And we say, you know, go ahead and look and even hack. In fact, if you understand what's going on in there, as you will by the end of this talk, you can actually do some pretty neat things. You know, you can kind of hack around and make life easier for yourself with these configurations. Okay, so we have some build system business going, and it also seems to be using SQLite to store packages. All right, so now we have the configuration. Let's go back to our package. So packages live in repositories. Repository can be a local file system path, or it can be a URL, a remote URL, HTTP or HTTPS. In our case, it's a remote one. And one of the things you will see in this repository, in the package version page, is the location. So this is the repository. So we're going to copy it. And we're going to add it to our configuration. We use the bpkg add command. Now, in more real-world scenario, you might have several repositories, so you'll keep adding them, you know, if you pull packages from different repositories. So once you're done, you run fetch. Fetch downloads the meta information about all the packages. Doesn't download packages themselves. Okay, so this hairy looking prompt is about authenticating repositories. So in build2, repositories are normally signed to prevent tampering with packages either in transmission or when someone breaks into your box. And we currently implement the first use model similar to SSH. Essentially, if a repository presents a certificate that hasn't been seen yet in this configuration, then you are prompted to authenticate it. And the way you do it normally is by comparing a fingerprint. So ideally, you would get a fingerprint via some other means, for example, an email announcement. But if you're in a pinch, you can go to the repository's about page, and you will see it there. So there's the fingerprint, besides other information. So you can see it starts with FF and ends with 94. And the same here. So sufficient for our simple needs. So it says, OK, downloaded information about two packages in one repository. Another useful ND command is status. It allows you to ask what is the status of any package in the repository. So here we see it says it's available. I'm not going to talk about that sys yet. I'll discuss it later if we have time. All right, well, without further kind of delay, let's just go ahead and build it. So we use the build command. So what build does, it goes ahead and it figures out all the dependencies and their dependencies and all their, and tries to satisfy all their version constraints. And then it presents you a plan, basically what it needs to do. So in our case, we see that hello depends on libhello. So otherwise looks reasonable. So we answer yes. All right. So this is all kind of live, running from live servers. So I have wired internet. I'm not playing with Wi-Fi here. So you can see a lot of action. Some things got downloaded, unpacked, configured, and built. But stuff that you would expect, right? Nothing surprising. Now, build is kind of a high-level command. So what it does, it takes a package in whatever state it is right now, and it brings it to the latest version up-to-date state. So if you had, for example, a package with an older version and there's a newer one available, it will upgrade it and bring it up-to-date. But there's also a way to split this in smaller pieces, and the two such commands are clean and update. Well, clean removes the build system output. It doesn't remove the package itself. If you want to drop the package, if you want to remove the package, you use drop command. And then update does the reverse. So it makes sure that the package is up to date and gets all the build system output in the up to date state. So let's clean our hello. And then we're going to rebuild it in verbose mode. So the idea here, we want to verify that, yeah, indeed, we're using GCC 5, as you can see, and we have an optimization option. The other handy command is test. If your package provides tests, as all good packages should, then you can run them. You can also inspect what's going on in our configuration. As you can see, there's a little bit more action going on in there. One of the directories is this hello-100 directory. And inside we see there's something that looks like an executable, right? So we actually can go ahead and run it. Okay, let's say we played around with this hello program, looks good. We notice that it depends on libhello, so let's go check out what's going on with this libhello library. So there we'll see two versions, right? So the one that we are using is from the stable section of the repository, but there's also one from testing, version 1.1, and notice also that it has two new dependencies. So it looks like there's some action going on, some active development. So let's go ahead and upgrade our hello to this newer version. Because it lives in a different section of the repository, we need to add this location to our configuration. And and we need to refetch. Notice that we're not going to get prompted again to authenticate anything because the repository is already known to this configuration. Let's see what's the status of libhello is. As you can see, we have a version 1.0 configured and we have version 1.1 available. No surprises there. Well, let's go ahead and upgrade it. So again, we, as I mentioned, build will upgrade things if they are not the latest version, so we'll just use this command. Okay, a little bit more interesting plan. The first two lines pretty clear because the new version of libhello now depends on two other libraries. Then we're upgrading libhello. The last line might seem a bit surprising, so we need to reconfigure hello. If you think about it, it makes a bit of sense. We are changing the version of libhello, and hello depends on it. So it might actually need to adjust to this new situation. So we need to reconfigure it. Okay, now that it makes sense, let's go ahead. All right, so now it's asking us, do we want to also update those dependent packages? Hello in this case. You might wonder why not just go ahead and update them all the time. Well, there's a good reason for that. Imagine you had 100 packages that depended on libhello, and you also want to only, you know, update this specific set. That's what you just want, interested right now. You don't want to wait half an hour for everything to update. So BPKG is kind of a very lazy package manager. That's its philosophy. You know, if it doesn't have to do anything, it's not going to do it by default. So it has to reconfigure, but it doesn't have to update. You know, you might want to update it later. But sometimes it's also kind of asks you, do you want to do a little bit extra where it makes sense? Okay, now in our case, it makes sense. Might as well do it. So again, a lot of action going on, downloading things, unpacking things, building things, but nothing that you would, nothing unexpected. Let's say we played with this new version, realized there's no new functionality, just two new dependencies. We don't like this kind of stuff, you know, it's useless. So we're gonna want to go back to our original version. So to downgrade our libhello, we just specify the version explicitly. You can also upgrade to a non-latest version by specifying some other version explicitly. Okay, the plan looks all right. Let's update dependence. All right, a new kind of prompt. So what happened is we removed this new version of libhello, which depended on these two libraries. So now they're not really needed. You know, we as an end user never actually asked to build them. So VPKG detects that and it offers you to clean them up since they're no longer needed, which is always a good idea. All right, so currently all our goodies, the things that we built are in this package manager, in this configuration directory, not easily accessible by other build systems. For example, if you're using Visual Studio and so on. So one way to export those things, the results of the build system, is to use the install command. So let's try to do that. So all we have to do is specify where to install it, things. So T is my alias for tree, by the way, and L for LS. So let's go see what's in there. All right, it's kind of standard Unix-y. All right, I have a question.
That blue font is really hard to read on the screen. Can you change the font?
I think it'll take me quite a bit of time, sorry.
Oh.
Yeah. Anyone knows how to disable three color in 10 seconds. But three. No, it's three.
If you just type it to cat.
Yeah, that might. Nope. Anyway, I think we'll go ahead. I'm not going to have too many of these. I hope it's you can still see a bit at least. But standard Unix. Dash N. Nope. Maybe the. Nope. Anyways, all right. So moving on. Standard Unix install structure. executables go to bin, include headers go to include libraries, and so on. But you can always customize it to your liking. You can even try to run it. Oops. Not what we expected. Well, if you think about it, it kind of makes sense. We installed our stuff into some random directory, and we cannot expect dynamic linker to look for the libraries there. So there are various ways you can fix it. You know, you can mess with environment variables, so you can go the libtool way and, you know, have a wrapper, shell scripts, and so on. The way I like to fix it is using rpath. So build2 provides you a uniform interface to rpath functionality for platforms that support it. So all I had to do is basically add this config bin rpath variable and specify the library where our shared libraries get installed. Everyone knows more or less what rpath is, right? Yeah, good. All right, so we installed. Notice these two link commands. This is where actually our executable and library got relinked with this new rpath. Let's try to run it. Oh yeah, I wrote an install. Good catch. Okay, let's rather install it. Okay, so now it runs. Well, you've seen our uninstall already, right? So you can also uninstall it. At first, it might seem kind of redundant, but it's actually very important. If you export several different packages from potentially different configurations, and then you want to, for example, remove one and replace it with a new version, you know, then removing the directory wholesale is not really an option. All right, so this is essentially a core of PPKG. Probably 95% of your use will be something like that. It follows a Git kind of structure of command and help, so you can run bpkg help, and you will see a list of the commands. It's probably about 15 of them currently, some lower level ones. If you want to learn more about this specific command, just run bpkg help in the command name. All right, so I mentioned that one of our primary technical goals is to have a uniform interface on all the platforms. So let's see how this same thing will actually look on Windows. A little bit of a reality check. So I have a little VM running here. It's a really small font. I hope we can see it, but I couldn't quite figure out how to make it bigger. So I have a Visual Studio 14 64-bit native development prompt open. So let's try to do the same set or subset of these steps, but build it for Visual Studio. So the first thing we create is a directory, right? We'll call it VC 14 release. Now we have the create command. The only thing I had to change is the compiler name, UCL now, and the optimization option looks a little bit different. Again, once we have the high-level high-level configuration, you'll be able to say something like VC 14 release, and it will automatically figure out what to do. Right, so we can even see what's in there. There's even tree command on Windows. Who knew that? So the same structure. We add the repository. Right, we fetch it. Same command, authentication prompt. Same plan. Let's see what we've got. So if we scroll a little bit up, we'll see the same lib hello dash 100. Notice there isn't an executable there. Let's try to run it. And it works. You can also install things. So let's say you want to use now this in Visual Studio. So I'll install in C hello. Right, kind of the same output. See what we've got. Same structure, more or less. Again, you can customize it pretty heavily if you want. Let's try to run it. Notice that we didn't have to mess with rpaths, right? Well, there's no rpath on Windows. But here it works automatically because the DLL is actually installed in the bin directory next to executable, so it works automatically. So for once, things actually work better on Windows than on Linux or Unix. Same story about uninstall, so we can remove the whole thing. All right, so as you can see, I think we pretty much achieved the goal of having a uniform interface. So it looks and works exactly the same, slash maybe different directory separators. All right, so you might be wondering what exactly makes a package. And there are two, well, besides having some source code, and there are two requirements. One is big, one is small. So the big one is you need to use the build2 build system. And the small one is you need to have a manifest file, provide a manifest file. Let's go take a look at the manifest, for example, for our Hello program. So it's pretty short, stuff that you would expect, name, version, license, there's our dependency clause. I'm not going to go into too much detail what all this means. You know, you can spend 60 minutes discussing what version means. The point is, if you're already using build2 as a build system, it's actually trivial to convert your project into a package. You just need to add like a half a page manifest. You know, you don't need to write Python scripts and so on. All right, so this is essentially the package manager, the perspective of an end user. So now let's change, you know, our hat and wear a hat of someone who is actually going to, you know, create a package using build2 as a build system. So we are going to write a little hello example, right? So this is, I lifted this from Wikipedia, a little bit adjusted, standard source file, right? Nothing surprising there. So this is what we start with. We have the hello zero subdirect. The zero stands for zero dependencies, so we're not going to mess with dependencies. Not enough time, but this is what we have. So during everyday development, you don't want to use package manager directly. You know, you don't want this unpack, download, fetch, configure cycles all the time. You might have a local repository, and you might have a number of configurations that you use for testing, for example, different compilers, different versions of packages. But for everyday kind of edit, build, test cycles, you want to use the build system directly. It's just more efficient. So let's see what it takes to convert this simple example into using build2 as a build system. The first thing that we need to do is create the build subdirectory inside. This is where all the project-wide build system files will live. In our case, we only need two. Now, I'm not going to go into detail why we need two instead of one and what their names mean. My goal here is to show you, kind of give you a feel what it looks like. You know, is it a few lines that make sense, more or less, or is it like five pages of gibberish? So the first file that we need to write is called bootstrap build. First thing we do there is name the project. So project is a special variable. Then we load two build system modules. One is config, the other one is install. Config implements all those config.variables that we've seen earlier. And install provides support for installation. All right. And we put it in this build subdirectory. The second file is called root build. So there, the first thing we do is specify the C++ standard. You know, we prefer to use 11. Then we load the C++ module. This is, by the way, the same CXX as we saw when we called bpkg create. So hopefully things starting to kind of connect a little bit. The last two lines specify the extensions that your project uses for C++ source files and header files. We'll see in a bit where it fits. All right, and we put it next to bootstrap build. All right, so final thing is the file that actually describes what we are building, right? So it's a one line, looks make-ish. We have a target on the left-hand side, executable. We have a source file on the right-hand side. Build2 is actually derives a lot of good things from make. We actually believe that make got a lot of things right. It was just designed 30 years ago and didn't kind of envision the current challenges. So in a sense, build2 is kind of fixed up make. All right, so as you might have noticed that we didn't specify the extension for our source file. So the build system will be able to figure it out from this extension. Might sound strange why we did that, but there's actually a very good reason why. If you want to know why, you can see a video of my C++ Now talk, which goes more in detail about the design of the build system. By the way, I don't know how many of you saw the clang module talk, the first talk this morning by Manuel, I think. And he mentioned they capture headers in their build files. So we do that too. And he said, but we don't distinguish between, we cannot distinguish between C and C++ headers. Well, we actually do. And the reason why we capture them, we haven't gotten to the problem that they are solving, but our problem is actually preparation of distributions. So, you know, if you want to package something so that someone else can use, you need to capture kind of the complete set of your source files and other files. We'll see that in a bit. All right, so we put this file in next to our hello source file, and that's pretty much all we have to do. So no long 5 pages of gibberish. All right, let's go see how it works. So I have exactly the same structure here, as you can see. So by convention, you know, if we run a build system, it should bring everything up to date. For example, if you run make, that's what happens. So we're kind of stuck with the convention. And if you run it, if we take a look what's in there, so now we have our executable, and we can run it. Right, if we run the build system again, well, it says everything is up to date. You can also clean the result of the build process. We now see back to the original. We can also specify the compiler we want to use. Let's say we want clang. Let's also run it in verbose mode, so we can actually see the underlying commands being executed. All right. So a little bit more output than probably most of you expected. I'm going to discuss this part in a few slides. So the part that is actually important here are these two lines. As you can see, we are using clang. Okay, so this is basic usage of the build system. Nothing surprising, I hope. Once you get past that, you will run pretty quickly into two problems. The first problem is you would like to have you would normally want to have several configurations going, you know, clang, release, GCC, clang, release, GCC, debug, and so on. The second problem are those configuration variables. It's going to get really tedious if you have to keep repeating them every time you run your build system. So we solved the first problem with out of three builds, and the second problem with persistent configurations, and these two kind of work hand in hand, so we're just gonna go take a look at them together. So I went one directory up, so here's our source directory, hello zero. So now we're gonna create let's create this GCC5 release configuration, the same we used for package manager. So let's start from the back. It looks a bit hairy at the beginning, but it's actually pretty simple. So these two variables we've already seen, right? Specify the compiler and optimization option. This scary looking thing is actually pretty simple. If you translate it to English, it says, hey, configure me hello zero source directory as hello zero GCC5 release output directory, right? Pretty logical. So if we run it, it's created a directory and saved something called config build. If we now take a look, indeed there is the directory. We can even go inside and take a look inside. Again, you see this build subdirectory. where all the build system related files are stored. There's the config build file. So let's go take a look at that. I think you can kind of follow the theme is that you should go and look at everything. You know, we don't say, hey, don't touch anything. So one of the problems that we also try to address with build2 is this. With a lot of build systems, like for example, Automake, if you want to tweak your configuration a little bit, you have to essentially kind of rerun configure, you know, remember all the options and so on. So this is a pain. So what we decide is, our goal is we want to have a configuration that you should be able to edit with your favorite text editor. And we'll see that in a bit. So as you can see at the beginning, there's a comment saying created automatically by the config module, but feel free to edit. Okay, for now we'll just notice that there is our GCC5, there is our O3 optimization option. As you can see, there's some other options variables. So there's a P option, which stands for preprocessor. There's a C option, which I mentioned stands for compile options, L option for link options, and so on, and some other things. We're not going to go into detail too much. All right, so let's run it. Let's build it. Using GCC5 release as expected. Notice also that we didn't specify the compiler. So this is now a persistent configuration. Okay, let's get the clang build going, right? So I'm just gonna go and tweak this a little bit. I have clang 3.6 on my box. So I'm just gonna adjust it a little bit. Okay, looks good, right? Okay, so now we have a clang subdirectory. So now I'm gonna do something neat. I'm gonna go ahead and build them both at the same time. So we're actually running several compilers in a single build system invocation. I don't think you see that very often. Now, this might seem like, okay, well, cool feature. You know, what's the big deal? This actually has a very important implication for parallel builds. Imagine you have 20 configurations, for example, in your nightly build. Let's say it's a library that has a lot of source files and a long link command at the end. So if you build them serially, what happens is you will compile all those source files in parallel, and then you have this long link command, which is utilizing only one core. All your other cores are idling. And so once you pass that, you're going to repeat it. If you throw it all at the build system at once, you know, you will utilize all your cores to the maximum all the time. While you're linking a previous configuration, the build system already goes ahead and keeps building the next one. So this is actually pretty important. Okay. So I mentioned cross-compilation is easy. Let's see how that works. Oops. Oh, sorry. Parallel builds are not implemented yet, so it's coming in the next feature, but they will be all on by default, yeah. Okay, so I have this compiler here. It's a MinGV cross-compiler on my Linux box, so let's see how we can use that. Actually, you don't have to do anything differently in build2. So all I'm going to do, I'm going to stick it in here. I'm going to change the name a bit. That looks good. So there we got the MinGV. We run the configuration using the MinGV. Didn't have to do anything differently. If we look inside, you might notice that now we have a hello.exe executable, right, named correctly. What do you think? Can we run it? Everyone understands how this works, no? So I have a wine set as an interpreter for Windows executables on my Linux machine. This is actually really handy. I mean, we run all our tests on the wine. I don't start my virtual machine very often anymore. Okay, so I don't know how many of you saw my lightning talk, but with a little bit of effort, we can run a Visual Studio compiler, toolchain, not Visual Studio IDE, but just the toolchain as a cross compiler. So I have a couple of versions going. This is the chatty output. So let's set that up just for interest's sake. So I have to adjust that. I have to change to, and we'll call it. So we'll see now we have that. Last one. We'll run it. Now those of you familiar with Visual Studio command line options will probably recognize it. So now again we have an executable which we can even run. So in what, probably 5-10 minutes, we set up builds for our project for all the compilers that really matter these days, right? So you can, you know, if you need to test, or I'm working with some modern C++, and I'm not quite sure this feature is actually supported by Visual Studio, for example. Well, what I used to do before is I would go and boot my virtual machine, copy my source code over, you know, open Visual Studio, compile, it doesn't work, so I have to fix something. So I find a workaround or a fix. Now I have to copy the source code back. Now the line endings are wrong, so I have to fix that. So in the end, what happens usually is like, yeah, it's probably working. You know, I'll shake it out during the release. And the end result of this all is that you dread this release because you know you're going to spend 2 weeks shaking all this stuff out. All right. So now we kind of covered the basics. A couple of cool features. One of them I mentioned is we want reliable builds. So the problem with the with kind of supporting reliable builds is that there's a lot of out of build file dependencies. You know, in your build file, you specify, okay, this is an executable, this is a source file. If the source file changes, you're gonna expect things to get updated. But there's other things, right? Well, by now, kind of everyone knows, okay, there are headers also. Your source file includes a header. If that changes, then you need to recompile executable. Most build systems kind of can handle it more or less if there's no generated header files. But there are other things here, right? You can change the compiler. You know, you can change GC to clang, or you can upgrade your compiler. You can change options. You can, you know, disable optimization, enable debug. So you would expect your things to be recompiled. There are also more subtle ones. Imagine you have an executable that depends on a bunch of source files, and you know your build is up to date. Everything is up to date. And now you realize, oh, I don't really need this source file. So you remove it. So most build systems will fail to notice this because from their point of view, everything is still up to date. So the make-based build systems, if you are familiar, you will often see a file sometimes called .d next to each object file, and it's usually a make fragment. So this is the extracted header dependency information. So what we did in build 2, you know, we realized, well, headers is only a small part of it. There's other things. So we generalized it, and we called it an auxiliary dependency database. So it's essentially a text aligner-oriented kind of text file where we store all kinds of out-of-build file dependencies that allow us to detect changes. So just for interest's sake, let's go take a look at it. We'll take a look at one for our object file. So we have them for executables, for libraries, where we keep track of all that stuff. All right, so you can see at the bottom there's a whole bunch of headers that we extracted. Then there are a couple of hashes. So we either store value, but sometimes it's more efficient to store hash. For example, we'll hash all the options and store that instead of the options themselves. So we have a hash for an option, then we have a hash for a compiler. So we checksum the compiler as well. So if you, for example, upgrade it or change the compiler, we'll detect that. Then this might look a bit curious. So the thing with this out of build file dependencies is that once you start thinking about it, you start discovering more and more and more of them. So this one deals with the upgrade of the build system itself. Imagine you upgraded the build system and the logic of the rule that compiles your source files changed. So you need to recompile it as well. So we actually store a rule ID in the dependency database. All right, but okay, so this is all kind of theory. What exactly does it bias? Let's go take a look at a few examples. So I'm gonna configure this our hello example, but I'll do it in source, so you can do that. I'm gonna use this C++ kind of generic alias for the time being. We'll see in a second what we're gonna do with it. All right, so I built everything. So now I have our hello example. You can see everything is up to date. So let's say we now realize, okay, we want to add an optimization option. We want to compile with optimization. So now is our time to try and edit that config build file. Oops. Okay, so we save it, and there we have our optimization. So the build system actually recognized that you changed the option and recompiled what's necessary. Okay, let's do something sneaky. Let's change the compiler and the build system's feet, you know, and see what happens. So remember, I configured it with using the C++ alias. Currently, it points to GCC. And we're going to sneakily change it, right? So there it's pointing to GCC. I'm gonna change it to clang with libc++. You definitely need to recompile for that, right? You're using a different runtime library. Let's see what we've got now. So clang. There again, we managed to detect that. Right, another cool feature is command line configuration variable overrides. The idea here is oftentimes you want to just change a couple of things or test a little bit different configuration. For example, you're working on code and you know it's some tricky part and you realize, well, clang is quite picky, so I would better test it that it actually works. But you don't want to go and create a new configuration just for that. Maybe you have one going already. But ideally, you would just want to temporarily switch to clang, test it out, and again switch back to some other compiler, for example. So that's one example. The other example, let's say you know, you're working on a program, dumped core, but you're compiling without debug, so you want to add debug support. So in build2, we have fairly comprehensive support for overriding things on the command line. So you can do an outright override. So you can ignore any the value that is in calculating the build file. So for example, this works for the compiler, to override the compiler. More interestingly, you can add a prefix or suffix to the value that is in the build file. So for example, you might want to add a suffix, a debug option at the end, so that it takes precedence over anything that comes before it. While for a library or include search, option, you want to stick it at the beginning so they actually search before anything that is in the build file. Just as an example, let's say we are working on our hello. You can see it's compiled with optimization and it dumped core. We cannot see stack trace, so we need to recompile it quickly with debug. So, you know, we can go and edit the build file, add the option, redo our stuff, remove it from the build file, but it's tedious. So all we have to do is there you have it. And you can see that the optimization option is still there. Just to show you that this is not some kind of, you know, in some build system it will be, oh, it's something changed, let's rebuild everything, you know, kind of panic mode. So this one actually tracks things fairly precisely. So let's change the compilation link option. So this one shouldn't affect compilation, right, ideally. Yeah, well, what I did is I removed the debug option, so it actually did affect compilation. Let me just rebuild it. So now we have everything up to date, right? And now we add a compilation override. I mean, link option override. As you can see, only the link command is executed.
So basically, when you added your compile option, it only added for that one line.
Yeah. So that is that.
When you change the link options, you forgot about the.
Right. So kind of leading to this point is the other useful place where you use this configuration variables overrides is when you want to tweak your configuration a little bit. You know, you can open the in a config build in the editor and fix it, but you know, sometimes it's just easier to do this. And if we grab it there, you can see it. You know, we still have the old option because we added our override as a suffix, and we now have a debug. All right. So besides, so I'm going to run maybe 5-10 minutes over time. So besides kind of standard, you know, update clean operations, there are also other operations that the build systems have to handle. Configuration is one of them. Some build systems decide, you know, no, we're going to, you know, it's a separate step. It's not our problem. I think this is a bad design because you gain a lot of things that when you can integrate the two. But there are other things, for example, tests. You might want to run tests. Well, it's a good idea to run tests for your project. So in build2, we have a test module which provides some interesting support. For example, you can specify a file, an output file to compare the output of your execution with. And we use diff, you know, to show you the differences. We're also planning to extend it significantly. I'll talk about that in a bit. The other operation is dist, so preparation of distributions. You know, if you want to create a clean package without your git ignore files and all other garbage, then you know it's fairly easy to do in build2. A lot easier than in automake if you had the pleasure. My kind of pet peeve, or you know, the implementations that I like to make fun of it, install. You know, the only implementation that I can kind of trust to do right thing most of the time is automake. But when you run it, you get this, you know, 3-page long shell command. You know, this thick thing. And if it works great, you know, you just kind of don't loop, okay? But if it doesn't, you know, good luck to you debugging this thing. The other thing is installation to system directories, right? All of us, I think, wrote, you know, sudo make install. But how many of you thought, why on earth are we running the whole thing as sudo, right? We are running make as sudo. We are running our compilers and linkers as sudo. So imagine something actually needs to be recompiled and you're building in your home directory. What will happen is you will have object files and libraries and executables owned by root in your home directory. This is not a rocket science. I mean, it's obvious. Why not just run, you know, the commands as sudo? So in build2, we cleaned it all up properly. So let's see how it works. So I'm going to install an opt system directory. So we need to specify sudo. Sudo can be sudo itself, but it can be something else. For example, fake root, if you're making, for example, a Debian package. All right, so conveniently for me, you know, we actually did have relinks here because we added this debug option in our configuration earlier. So as you can see, the compilation is actually done without sudo, but the installation is done with sudo. Uninstall works exactly the same. All right, so these are kind of three cool features. I had time to show examples. A couple of more just to give a brief description. So if you have dependencies, let's say your hello depends on libhello, then you need a way to connect things together. You know, you cannot assume that everything is installed and you know, in the location where the compiler searches by default. So in build2, we have an explicit mechanism for importing things, for connecting things together. And it has kind of several stages, but the interesting part is what happens is what we call a rule-specific search. is what happens when you couldn't find a project. You know, there's no build2 project, and now you need to look for something installed. You know, we should be able to use libraries that are installed that not even built, but build2. And what we do is, so in naive kind of implementation would be like, for example, that's what make does. It says, okay, well, I need to look for install. I know where things are installed, right? They're in USR lib and USR, you know, local lib. Well, except when you're cross-compiling, they're not there, right? So what we did in build2, we actually postponed this import installed to to the rule that will actually link things. And this rule knows exactly which kind of which compiler or linker it's going to use. So it can extract the actual search paths that's specific to this target and search for them in there. So there, the cross-compilation kind of non-issue. We also have PKG config integration. Also, it's a bit broken when it comes to searching things in the face of cross-compilation. So we fix that by actually finding the PC file ourselves. You know, we find the library, and then we look for the PC file in the corresponding directory, and then we use it. Right, subprojects and amalgamation, in short, they support for bundling things together. You know, you drop one project into another. The outer one becomes an amalgamation. Inner one becomes a subproject. Two things happen. You know, import machinery automatically finds things in your from your subprojects, and also the subprojects start inheriting configuration from the amalgamation. So you know, if you specify GC5, you'll only have in the amalgamation unless you override it in the subprojects. So we haven't used amalgamations, but BPKG configuration, the package manager directory that we create, is actually an amalgamation. And remember I mentioned, hey, you actually might even want to hack stuff around. So, you know, if you know that, you can actually do some cool things. You can build your little programs for testing in the BPKG configuration. It'll automatically find all the packages that are installed in there. So some cool hacks you can do. Right, library dependency export. So the kind of the other side of the medal when it comes to import is export, when it comes to libraries. And when you want to link a library, it's seldom it's sufficient to just get the library itself. You often need to pass other information as well. For example, where to look for headers or which other libraries to link. And when it comes to linking libraries, there's a problem with which set of dependent libraries you have to link. There's even terminology for that, underlinking or overlinking. In build2, we actually divided all library dependencies into two categories. It's an interface and implementation dependency. So interface dependency, just to give you an example, would be, let's say you have you are using another library in your library, and what you do is you call that library API in your inline functions. So if someone links your library and uses those inline functions, from the linker's perspective, it's as if you actually use the third library directly. So most modern linkers, for example, on Linux, will refuse to link your executable if you don't link to that third-party library. So this is called underlinking. So in build2, we kind of took really careful thought about this and fixing this properly. We have support for library versioning. Currently, it is only supports platform-independent versioning, so we embed the version into the library name as well as the so name, but we also plan to support platform-specific versions like on Linux and Windows. Okay, rpath, we saw how to use it. We also do an implicit rpath if you are building a non-installed executables, and the idea here is that you want to actually be able to run your things once you build them, without any shell scripts or messing with environment variables. The one cool thing is there's no rpath support on Windows. So what we did, we actually provided an emulation of it with using Windows side-by-side assemblies. So it's pretty hairy, but it works really well. You can actually run things on Windows. Right, so briefly what's next? Maybe I'll just skip it. So parallel builds, documentation, improvements to the test module, package manager, system packages, build-time dependencies, and build-bot is coming soon. And all this source code, introduction, installation instructions, all on build2.org. Sorry for going over time. Thank you very much. I'm happy to answer any questions if anyone has. Yeah. Create, yes, there's dist module. Oh, sorry. The question was, is there an automated way to create packages and then upload them to the repository? There is a way to create the packages, this dist module. Basically, it prepares the distribution, goes all the way to creating you an archive. Uploading, not yet. BPKG provides support for creating a repository. So you basically, essentially what you do, you copy a bunch of these archives that you've got into a directory, you know, provide a couple of description files, you know, name of the repository, then you run a BPKG command, it generates this meta information about all the packages. You know, you can sign it, good idea, you know, create a certificate, sign it. And then, you know, usually use rsync. We don't have a built-in support, but probably could be provided. You will be. Oh, the question is, so if there are different languages and, yeah, even different tools, will we be able to use them in build2? And the answer is yes, you will eventually. So the idea is that, as I said, you know, it's not a black box. We have a mental model how things are built. So you'll write a rule, which will be written in C++, by the way, and or a module that provides a rule, for example, for doxygen, and yeah, and then it will work exactly the same like C++ compilation. So C++ compilation is not something that is, you know, hard-coded into the build system. There is a module called C++ that implements a rule for C++ compilation and linking and so on. So do you want me to answer a question? Okay, so the question was, how does this Visual Studio and the Linux compiler works? Is it running under Wine, or is it a Linux version of the Visual Studio? I wish there was a Linux version of Visual Studio, but it is running under Wine. So it's a little thin wrapper. You know, you cannot just run it under Wine. You also need to translate paths so that it behaves as a real cross compiler. We're actually gonna publish this, clean it up a little bit, and publish it as an open source project. The cool thing about doing it under Wine, for example, is that you can have all the versions of Visual Studio, including different updates. For example, I can have, you know, Visual Studio 14 update, you know, no update, update Wine, update 2, and update 3, which you cannot do on your Windows machine. So the question is, which major libraries do we have packaged and available in the repository? Currently, not many. So probably the most popular that everyone now knows is libsqlite. We have that one packaged, but some days I feel, yeah, I'm gonna go and package, you know, half of them right away. But I also realize, you know, the build system is still a bit in flux, so it means I'll have to, you know, come and redo probably a lot of that. So, you know, I'm trying not to, you know, we are probably slower than most people hope, but we just want to get it right.
Any desire for Android and iOS support?
Any desire or plans?
Plans, sure.
So the question is, any plans for iOS and Android support? Yes, a lot of plans. That's kind of where the major pain comes in our own use case. You know, it's all this mobile, you know, little things that change, you know, Apple basically changed things the way I build with every release. So that's the problem. And I mean, that's kind of the long-term plan that we trying to address. Okay, I don't know. Okay, let's go.
So I noticed that repackaged add used HTTPS. Are there other protocols?
Okay, so the question is, are there any other protocols for repositories besides HTTPS? Well, you can have local repositories. You can have a directory on your file system and it can act as a repository. For remote repositories, not at the moment. We thought about, you see, I guess a Git could be, a Git directory could be a repository, but we're also thinking about, well, I guess I'll need to step back. So in BPKG, you can specify a package and it'll come from a repository, but you can actually specify a directory to a package or a directory to an archive. So it'll use, it will kind of build this package without going through any of that repository business directly, which is quite handy for testing. So what we thought about in the context of build automation is instead of giving a package archive or a package directory, you get you give it a URL, a Git URL to a package, and it downloads it and builds it. So that would be cool for build automation. For example, you know, you're working on a branch and you want to test it with all different compilers, you just push that branch and a build bot on the other side pulls it from Git and builds it for you and pushes the result. But I think the idea of having a repository in Git is pretty cool as well. Thanks. I think the back there.
So if you have multiple sites that you're getting packages from, is there a central index so it knows where each package came from? So if you were to do it, let's say, you know, I want to update my packages or look for updates.
I'm not sure I follow.
So you have your own site where you're hosting some packages, but maybe Boost is going to want to host their own packages on their own site. But what, is there an index on your local machine that says, I got this package from boost.org, and I got this package from build2.org, and I got this package from a local thing, so that way you can say, so you can say, just update all my packages.
Okay, so let me try to. So the question is, is there a central place that keeps track which packages come from which repositories? This information, so, you know, in BPKG, there's no such thing as something central. You know, there's no, like, something in your home directory. Everything is localized in this configuration. So when you fetch things, yes, all this information is there and you can query it. But, you know, you can have a different configuration, it'll have completely different things. So hopefully that answers. Okay, one more question. Yeah.
That may be related to that. If there's a subproject, could that have a different source repository?
Subproject. So the question is, if there's a subproject, can it have a different source repository? No, subprojects is, you mean this amalgamation and subprojects. So those are kind of bundles. Once you bundle it, it's kind of this unit that you just ship everywhere. Maybe one more, please. Good question. So the question is, how do we establish a connection between the compilers and bin utils, for example? It's done in a compiler-specific way. So we know, for example, for Visual Studio, it lives in the same directory and it's called link. So in a sense, we derive a pattern from for example, a compiler. So, you know, pattern, if you see it CL14-14, so the pattern will be *-14, and then we look for a linker by substituting that pattern with a linker name. But it is a big problem, and kind of a related problem for it is how do you find bin utils when you cross-compile? You know, like I showed, for example, I use this MinGV cross-compiler. We derive a pattern there as well, because you need to, for an archiver, for example, for a libtool, you need to use this I64R instead of system R. So yeah, so some thought went into that. Cool. Thank you very much, but I'm happy to answer questions still.